Would you stand with us, please? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. God, our Father, we beseech thee now that thou wouldest hear us. We come humbly yet boldly before thy divine throne, asking that you would forgive us, cleanse us. And dear God, in the process, knowing that you're just preparing us, that time when you shall present us faultless before your Father, our God. Now, God, we'd ask that you would do what only you can do. Minister to those hurts, those feelings of loss, of emptiness. Touch areas of our lives that no one can see with the naked eye. And in so doing, we will be able to go forward as we still celebrate the life of Fernando while mourning his loss. This we pray in Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Amen. want to call our attention to reading of God's Word. First from the book of Proverbs, chapter 3. And with verse 5, it simply says, "Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path." And then there's writing from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verse 18. It says, "Yet what we suffer now is nothing compared to the glory he will reveal to us later." What a word. What a word. Times of reflection. Few have gathered together simply to pay their respects, to share in various memories that we have of Fernando. And I'll begin by simply saying that I remember him and always referred to him as Maestro, simply because he was an artist. When it came to music, when it came to musical talents, he was the maestro. Fernando was a very unusual person. Didn't seem to get rattled by a whole lot. I remember having to bring him into my office for a little one-on-one talk. He had done something and I was upset. I mean, I was upset. I'm putting it mildly, I was. Thank you. And so I asked him to come in and we had a little chat. I asked our director of ministry development, Mr. Gerald Flowers, to sit in because I didn't want anything crazy to go down. And I wanted Gerald to be able to say, "Hold it, peace be still," or whatever. So he sat there and I went off on Fernando. Y'all remember, I told you I was upset. And amazingly so, he just sat there and looked at me and, "Okay, I'll sit here until you get through." And that's what he did. Eric, boy, just sit there. And that made me even mad. And I'm like, "Man, can I arouse something you just..." And so I got frustrated and finally I said, "Hopefully I've conveyed my message," and I get out of my office. And the amazing thing is that when all was said and done, he was like, "We cool, man. We cool. You did what you had to do. I'm going to do what I'm going to do, so we cool." But you know, when we understand that kind of spirit, we understand that you can accept discipline and understand that it's fair, even though it may be meted out harshly. But you are there to do a job. You are there to provide ministry of music, and that you're going to be held accountable. That's one thing I will always appreciate about Fernando. He took it and he went back to doing what Maestro could do, playing and developing talent. That brings me to my final point, and then it will be open for whoever wants to speak. And when we have the memorial service, those who are here from First Baptist, Warner Robins, just pretend you hadn't heard it before, okay? But Fernando was loyal. That touches me to the core. He was loyal. And in an age and in an era where people are running after this, this, and that, there seems to be no loyalty except to self. He was loyal to the ministry, to the church at First Baptist, 210 Garvin Street, Warner Robins, Georgia, 31088. And for that, I will eternally remain grateful. Eric, he was loyal. The floor is open for those who would like to share something about your relationship, your memory, or maybe you just want to add a word of encouragement to the family. If so, we invite you to come and do so now.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Certainly, to Eric and the family, I've been known as Fernando,
Rodriguez,
Rod, and those that went to Alabama State known as Cookie too. And so, he was, as Pastor said, he was a special person. And on the obituary, I see that Eric added a picture. We was actually in Minnesota. Ron had the privilege to be a part of the Clark Brothers, still nominated in 2013, and he actually played on that project. Ron also had that, he had the blessings of doing some things that only people have to dream of. This particular picture, we were in Detroit Lakes, Minnesota, with major names in Christian music, Rebecca St. James. I mean, the list goes on and on. And only four of us went, and Rob was one of the four. And we had an opportunity to be a part of the Power of God band. We were the only black ones. But yet we stood out. And that made a lot of people want to be around us, even including, and I learned something on that trip. You know how we get to the place where we want to be so big, and you really meet people who actually arrive, and they want to sit down and eat with you.
Amen.
We don't have that again in church. I was at Rod's initial sermon. He was a minister. He preached his initial sermon in Montgomery at Hutchinson, Reverend GWC Richardson. And also, something funny, Rod had an opportunity to go to Canada with Clark Brothers for the first time. And we went on that trip, and everybody fell in love with him. No matter where we went, everybody fell in love with Rod. Rod wasn't doing no singing. He was playing, but everybody fell in love with Rod. And one funny thing, we had an opportunity to sing for Disney World three times as that special guest. So we went to Disney World and we was going somewhere. I think we was going to Disney World to enjoy ourselves. Rod starts when he like, put some in the oven. And we like, why would you do that? Don't worry about it, boy. But he was very talented. And listen, the guys, someone was trying to come, they on the bus getting ready to go to Florida to sing. But Rod did a lot for CE Records. Matter of fact, I have a CE Records hall that CE Records donated, and this obituary actually is going on the memorabilia wall. His picture's already on there, so it's going on the wall because a lot of our classmates, some of the staff that's working with the funeral home, we all were classmates. Mm-hmm. I think there's one classmate over here. And we're just certainly thankful for his life and the gift that God gave him. And one thing that I'm going to try to find, that I'm going to share with you all, he did a CD of music. And his idea was, Anthony, they need something when they ready to get ready to relax, they can go to sleep on. So I got to do a lot of digging to try to find this music. And again, he is, my hat's off to the family. And he did leave something here, a legacy. He did one more thing. He recorded a song on one of our projects. The song says, giving praise. The song says, lift up your hands in the sanctuary, giving praise. Lift up your voice to sing a new song, giving praise. And if God's will on our next album, I'm planning to put that on our album so that we can remember what he has done. And I'm trying to find the music that he's done and something else he did that it's just so much of what I did. And we're just thankful to y'all, Eric, the family. Anytime you need us, we will be there for you. On behalf of our class, I don't know if some of them have something to say, class of 1988 Tuskegee Institute High School, we want to say we support you and we love you.
Praise the Lord, everybody. My name is Dolores, and like Pastor Clark said, we also part of this graduating high school class. So I've known Rodriguez for most of my life. I also went to Alabama State University, where I was reintroduced to Cookie. Cookie? Where did you get Cookie from? But he was Cookie, and a type of local celebrity at Alabama State University. And then I don't know what happened between us graduating from Tuskegee Institute High School to me reacquainting with him at Alabama State. But he had gone from just a local kid who played music at church to the maestro. When I met him at Alabama State, it was with the Voices of Praise Gospel Choir.
Amen.
Amen. And Cookie was a legend with that choir. He was bossy. he would point his finger at the sopranos and the altos and put his hands like this and fuss at us. But he was a master, not only at playing the piano, but then I understood he could sing. He just started belting out. That was his when we were in Tuskegee. I don't know what happened. But he would sing, and we would drive up and down the roads. Here in Alabama, we traveled to Chicago and Detroit, and so he sang all over the country, and we were blessed by his music, his friendship, his no-nonsense approach to teaching music and handling choirs, but also his generosity and his giving spirit. He didn't just drive by himself, but anybody who needed a ride could jump in his car. He had this big old car. I don't remember what kind it was. But, oh my goodness, I can't imagine how much it costs to put gas in it. but he would load his car up, I think more people than really supposed to be in the car. And we would go to Florida and sing and all over the country. I want the family to know how much he meant to us. He was a vital part of the Voices of Praise Gospel Choir of the campus at Alabama State University, and certainly of this community. His life mattered.
Yes.
His life
matters.
Yes. He was able to use the call of God on his life to bless thousands of people that you might not ever meet, but know that he mattered and he used his gifts to glorify God in every place he could find himself in. The first song I ever heard him sing, and the one that sticks in my memory, is a song done by the Gospel Music Workshop of America with John P. Key called Getting Your House in Order. Right? Getting my house in order so I'll be ready when he comes. I want you to know that no matter what he went through, he had his house in order. He knew in whom he believed, and he lived out his faith every day. We will miss him until we see him again, but we loved him, and his life mattered to us and to so many people. God bless you. Our prayers and thoughts are with the family. Please let us know if there's anything we can do.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
I'm standing here on behalf of the Voices of Praise as well as ASU Theater Department under the direction of Dr. Thomas Stewart, my brother Larry Watson. So good to see him. My name is Michelle Summers, and let me be very clear, my journey with Rodriguez Fernando Cookie Sullins was very unique. As Larry Watson knows, when I came to Alabama State, I could not sing. I grew up in Chicago. My parents were in the Tommies, but I was not a vocalist. My father was. And one of my most beautiful experiences, and yet very cookie experiences, was he was teaching my Minds Made Up. And I felt like there was something that was not right. And I kept saying, Cookie, that's not right. And he said, well, Michelle, Shelly, come play it. I said, oh. And ever since then, Cookie was truly a big brother to me. I'm standing here on behalf of Dion Hood. Him and Cookie were best friends. They were roommates. And they were trendsetters. Both of them decided to relax their hair, and my friend Renaco was responsible for Dion, and I was responsible for Cookie. And I'll never forget the type of car it was. Cookie loved Cadillacs. And he had an old school Cadillac, and after any practice, we did plays from, wow, we did Jesus Christ Superstar, we did Bubbling Brown Sugar, Gospel at Colonis, and what's interesting, Gospel at Colonis, Cookie redid the music. So when you hear the score from Colonis and what we did, a genius, a savant, extremely unique. He was the minister of music at our church, Hutchison. He could take someone like me, and the joke was when I got ready to sing my part, between him or Larry, someone would just bang my note, and Cookie could not understand. Why didn't she can't hear? Shelly, you got to be here an hour early. And boy, Cookie would tell me his hair was so beautiful and it was long and it was down his back, and he'd say, Shelly, you have to flatline my hair because I can't be out here looking any type of way. And we're late today because I woke up last night to Larry calling saying I'm going to do what I can to be here, but this morning I was on the phone with Dion, and I'm going to leave you with this. Dion made an observation which was so true. I never saw Cookie mad. I never saw him go off on anyone. We could be in a huge group of us and we could be dragging somebody through the slime and the mud. Cookie was a man of God. So he never joined in with the dragging. He would always give us a spiritual significance to what had happened and what we needed to do to support, to uplift, to change, that would make us better as well. When we heard of Cookie's passing, we had just buried Montrevell Williams. These were giants of ASU. There should be a plaque erected somewhere at Lila Barlow Theater in honor of Cookie. There are people right now currently on Broadway and in TV and film, and I'm not exaggerating. I'm not talking about extras. I'm talking about Dion, who is over fine arts in Dallas, Texas. And I hope, I don't know if you've already spoken, Larry, but when you said last night that the musician I am today is because of Cookie. Musicians charge thousands of dollars now to just sit at their church on Sunday. Thousands of dollars to accompany you, or hundreds of dollars, but Sullins, never the case. When we think about the theater and how iconic it is, it was because Cookie would sit at that organ, and to this day, and for the record, there is no one in this world that can wear a Hammond out the way Cookie could. I have been in the presence of stars who sat in awe of him. We are hurt and we are saddened by his loss, not because he is gone, but because of the absence we will feel. But I told Larry last night, and I told Dion, baby, listen, when Cookie's foot stepped in paradise, the angelic choir that now has everything it needs, yeah, the soloist that now has somebody that you ain't got to tell them your key, mm-hmm, he can hear it, The person that came that didn't need anything to transcribe, am I using the he could do it off of a whim. The person that someone tone deaf like me could start singing and he could find me. So when his pain was too much and the anguish was too much, God reached down and picked one of the most beautiful flowers out of the garden. And so Cookie, rest well, my friend. You will never be forgotten. Rest well, my friend. Rest well in perfect melody. You are loved and you will be missed. And to his brother and the family, thank you. Thank you for giving him to us unapologetically. Thank you, because he is a gem that we will never forget. God bless you.
Amen. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord
again, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
It is not often that your paths cross with a genius. It's not often that your paths cross with someone who's so connected to their gift, it's all about them and their gift. Rodriquez Sullins was music, and music was Rodriquez Sullins. I was a student at Tuskegee University in the graduate program in 1992. And the Lord spoke to me and told me to go to Alabama State. And I was confused by that. Why would you tell me to go to Alabama State? And I'm a graduate student at Tuskegee. Because he knew that my path needed to cross with my friend Rodriquez Sullins. So I packed my bags and I went to Montgomery. I auditioned for plays, and the next thing you know, Rodriguez and I had connected. And the ministry of music between the two of us was just phenomenal.
Yeah.
It was just phenomenal. And when I found out that he had passed, there was nothing that would stop me from coming. I live in Durham, North Carolina. Now, there was nothing. I didn't care how much it cost. That's how much Sullins meant to me. There was one time that I remember Rodriguez, Dion were roommates, and they said, Larry, instead of you driving back to Tuskegee, you wasting a lot of money. You might as well hang out with us and we just do the best we can to make it. Because sometimes when you're in college, you don't have the resources that you need to do what you need to do. And you have to depend on each other. And I will never forget, we were so broke that all we could buy was a 2-liter Sprite. And Rodriguez Sullins says, it will not always be this way.
Amen.
We drinking this now, but we going to drink and eat well one day, because God will raise us up.
Amen.
God will do it. I mean, that night was a special night. I mean, we just sat there, one little round table and a bottle of Sprite in the middle, and we just kind of laughed. And as the years have gone on, God truly has raised up Dion, he's raised up Rodriguez, raised up myself. I'm just honored to have gotten up early this morning to travel to pay my respects to this man of God. And one word that sticks out to me as I take my seat is dedication.
Yes.
Not many musicians are dedicated to the craft, to the anointing, to the gift. Many times I lived in married student apartments. I was married at the time, praise the Lord, but amen. Rodriguez would come and I would say, Rodriguez, let's just go out, let's just do something, have fun. He said, oh, no. I said, what you want to do, Rodriguez? I forget the name of the church right around the corner. He said, I'm going to practice. I said, well, Rodriguez, it's a Friday night. I don't care. I'm going to practice. And I would get that long car, I think he had a Lincoln Continental. It was a white car, it was long. And it used a lot of gas. We got in that Lincoln a many a night and went, forget the name of the church. He sat on that organ, I sat on that piano, and it was just marvelous. So I want to say to the family, absent from the body, but present with the Lord.
Amen.
And for that, I am grateful, because we all will see this place at some point. And to you, Cookie, thank you for being who you were. Your spirit of humility and dedication has impacted me greatly, and I will most certainly miss you. Rest in peace, my friend.
Terry, I'm a cousin to Rodriguez, Cookie, Mr. Sullins, whatever you want to call him. He had so many names, but we knew him as Rod. And he was more like a son or nephew or whatever. You see, I'm much older, but anyway, it's all right. But whenever he would get sick, he would always inform me. And he called me one time and told me that he was in the hospital and he was in Runner Robins, Georgia. I never knew nothing about Runner Robins, Georgia. But I told my son, and so he said, well, we'll get you there. So they got me there because he said he wanted to see somebody in the family. So when somebody tell you they want to see somebody in the family and they're looking for you, what you do, you go.
Yeah.
However you can get there, you go. And he called me. We was up in Savannah coming through there. And my daughter says to me, she says, you talked to Rod Little? I called him on the phone. We was about a block or two from where he was in the hospital again. And we stopped by to see him. And then this time he was in the hospital and he was getting ready to leave from Running Robins to go to Grady. And there was a young lady there with him that I don't know nothing about. But she took it upon herself to inform us, to inform me where he was going, how he was going, and she was going too. And all through the time that he was there, she stayed in touch with us. And I'm like, most of the time people just tell you your loved one is in the hospital and you do whatever. But I got a phone over there that got texts in it from her texting me. She would text, she called. And she was persistent because she just kept on. She wanted to get in touch with Eric. So she didn't get him, I don't think, at first, but she kept on. So she got Eric, she got me. And it's like, you all gonna do something, you know, I'm up here, but y'all gonna move. So me and Eric went at different times, but we found ourselves up there at Grady Hospital to see Rod. And I just thank her because she didn't have to go beyond just calling us and telling us that he was in the hospital. But I just thank her for just being there because she, I know the doctors and nurses probably got tired of it too because they would give him up. I'll tell you, Rod came back to life like three or four different times because she would call and they doing this procedure, they doing another procedure, something else wrong. Next thing you know, he's talking on the phone, you hear him talking. And then we even did a video where I'm looking at him and he's doing this, you know. So. And every time the doctors would say one thing, she would say, no, I think we need to take and do something else, or we need to try something else, and we're not just going to let it go. And she's back and forth, and I'm praying for her because she's leaving from Ronald Robbins coming to Grady. And I just thank her so much for that. Ms. Joshi, I just thank you so much because you didn't have to do what you did, but you did. And I want to say Mr. Rod Sullins was something else because he was trying to teach my daughter some lessons as they both was going to Miss Allen. But she went over there one day to the house with him and I picked up, she told me, I ain't going back over there no more. Not with Rod. She wasn't going back because Rod wasn't, you know, playing around. He was serious about what he did. And I heard someone say about his sermon that he did in Montgomery. I was there with my Aunt Lizzie May. But she was crazy about him too. But I just want to say to everyone, you keep looking up, and keep God ahead of everything. And when you feel down, call out to Him, cry out to Him, because He hear you, and He will answer you, and He will help you on through what you're going through. And I just thank all of you so much for coming and seeing about Him. And I want to thank Charles back there, because he came and he helped raise him too, and his father helped in his life. And we just thank all of you all. And he even came and one night he spent the night. My husband had to help him with his car. Something went wrong with his car. But like they said, he did have them big cars, and he was going to drive them no matter what. But I just thank you all so much. And I just thank God that I had him in my life. And when he called, I would come. And I would go and do what I could for him. And I'm there for the family. And Eric, we're going to stay in touch with you and your wife. We're going to stay in touch whether you all texting. And I'll just have to call on because I do a little texting, but they tell me all the time that I'm not good at it. But I just thank you all so much. I just thank you. Just thank you, thank you, thank you. And we just keep looking up and keep loving our hearts and praying to God, and we'll make it on in to see Him again one day.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
He was very instrumental in GMWA, not only, and he worked for First Baptist Church for over 20 years, and you don't hear that in a musician at this day and time. He was very dedicated. He had a life, he was a lifetime member of GMWA. You don't hear that. Also, he was a member of the Thomas Dorsey Convention and the Hampton Convention. I didn't know anything about GMWA, the Hampton Convention, or the Thomas Dorsey Convention until I met Cookie Rodriquez Sullins. And I am so happy that our paths crossed. When I found out he had passed, well, just let me go back and say this. We used to talk often on the phone, and we fought like sisters and brothers. We did, and we would get mad. We would not speak. I would turn my head, he would turn his head, and then we would come back together and act like nothing would happen. He would blast us out in choir rehearsal, and then after choir rehearsal, because he would talk about his bad, especially if you could not sing your part. So, so after he would talk about us really, really bad, beat us down. He's like, do you want to go and get something to eat? And so we would go and get something to eat. He wouldn't bring it up again. He would laugh and talk. But let me go back a little bit. I would just like to thank Yosha for what she did for Fernando. We would often talk about, I said, Fernando, what do you want me to do if something happens to you? He said, Yosha knows what to do. I said, Yosha. I would get mad because I thought it was supposed to be me. He said, no, Yosha is going to take care of business. She knows how to conduct business, and she's going to do the right thing about me. Although they didn't talk often, but Yosha knew exactly what to do for Fernando. And it wasn't just a month or 2 months. It was 7 months. And just let me say thank you, Yosha, from the bottom of my heart for taking care of Fernando. And it wasn't easy. I just went once to see him. I called him. I texted him often. But you were up and down that road constantly. And I just want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. It takes people like you and people like me and people like all of us to support a person like him. Fernando. Fernando had a way of sucking all the air out of the room when he entered into the room. He was just that type of person, a genius. He told me once in our conversation that when he was like about 14, he put a car on layaway. and paid for because he was working. He started working when he was very young for church, in churches. He also told me that he started playing the piano around about 4. They figured out that he could play. He was playing. He was over to one of his cousin's house, and he had one of these little small pianos. And he picked out one of those hymns, and they thought it was the little girl, whoever she was. He said, "Who is that playing?" He said, "Robin May," or whatever her name was. He said, "No, that's me, Fernando. I'm playing one of those hard-to-play hymns." But they found out at 4 that he could play music. And so from then, from 4 on up to now, his journey started. I've shared with a lot of people that Fernando had passed, all my friends, and it was like they knew Fernando personally because I would talk about him all of the time. I would talk about the good times. I would talk about when we're not speaking. I would talk about when I'm mad with him. I'm talking about when we're having a big concert and things was bothering him, things wasn't going his way, and we were just trying to figure it out. I was always talking about Fernando. To the point that my sister sent me a card the other day. And when I told her, I said, "Fernando passed." And she said, "Oh, no." I said, "Yes." And I had told everybody that he had been in the hospital, had been struggling. And the card reads, it just came yesterday. I want to share this with you. It said, wherever a beautiful soul has been, there is a trail of beautiful memories. In time, may healing come with little memories of all the special times you share. And we shared some very special times. I can't even begin to tell you how much your brother means to me. He will always hold a special place in my heart and GMWA heart. The people from GMWA, some of the board members are here. And if you're a member of GMWA, would you please stand right now, please? Please. So this is some of the people who came from GMWA. And GMWA stands for the Gospel Music Workshop of America. And we've just been a part of all for ever since we met, you can make sense of it. We met Fernando. He was a giver. He gave a, we did, it wasn't a paid position. Nowadays, you can't get a musician to play for you, and they would say, "How much are you paying?" I said, "It's not a paid position." He played for us for over 15 years without being paid. That's unheard of. He would travel with us, and he would carry us sometimes in a big car, like y'all see. And we would go to the convention, we would go to the Thomas Dorsey convention, we would go to the Hampton convention, we would go to the GMWA convention. He said, "You're not going to be around me and not learn about something about music. You are going to be a better person musically." And that's what he strived to do. He was a giver, a giver. And I just want to say thank you, Eric, for sharing him with us. Thank you, God, for making him. And Fernando, I feel lost without you. And I'm going to miss you, Frank. I'm going to miss you. Thank you.
Fernando didn't start with the choir.
My friendship started with Fernando back in June of 2008, when my father passed. And Fernando came down to see me and to check on the family and see how everybody was doing. And when he walked in through the door, I was in the kitchen, and he said, you gonna make me some cheese grits? In spite of everything was going on, I had to make him some cheese grits. He was always thinking about food, and until he took his last breath, Fernando wanted a cheeseburger. He said he wasn't eating anything unless they gave him a cheeseburger. But I wanted to touch on what a maestro is. And it's a distinguished musician, especially a conductor of classical music. A maestro is someone who is skilled enough to be considered an artistic genius. And from the testimonies of his friends, of his family, of Pastor, as he so delicately gave him the nickname of maestro, that was Fernando. That was our Fernando. And the hard work is done over now. He did all his work. I remember while going through some of his effects at the house before I closed it up, I said, there's got to be something of him that is just so unique. And I remember at our Christmas cantata, Greg, he conducted our choir, and Fernando, I call him Freemando, he conducted the instruments of praise. And so as me and my own way talking to him before I left the house yesterday, I said, I need something. And so I had found what they called a conductor's wand. And it was his conductor's wand that he conducted our Christmas cantata with. And I would like to give this wand to Eric, because this is who Fernando was. He was music. And you can tell at the tip of this wand, he's been banging on something. But this is what I found.
Fernando has touched many lives, lives that are not even present today. My prayer is that when my journey is over, my life will live on in somebody else, that they will have gleaned something from being around me, being close to me, that will help them to be a better person. Fernando has done just that. He's helped many to become better people. Not just musically so, but in living a life for the Master. Being a better person. Thank you for that, Fernando, for all of your kindnesses and all of the lessons taught to many people, for all of the friendships that have been spoken of in this place today. Yosha, I particularly got to point you out. You got on my nerves sometimes, I didn't tell you. thought that you ought to be spending some time with me. Yes, selfishness on my part. But where are you going? I'm going up to the hospital. But you know I wouldn't have it any other way. Going to take care, to see about a person, to make sure that they were getting the best of care. And Erica, I want to tell you, she did that, man. Talking to doctors, giving Fernando, hopefully, a will to want to live on. She did that. Now I'll tell this final thing before committal. As I visited him in the hospital, he was still bossy. Man, I'm there talking to him, hey man, blah, 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 they ain't doing right. I said, chill, man, I'm talking to myself and I just let him rant and rave. Yeah, when all this is over, I got something to tell you. We gonna talk. Eric is as talented as he was. He was the bossiest maestro. But you know, it takes that kind of take charge person to work in music. It takes somebody who is thick-skinned, because I've discovered, I'm definitely not musically inclined, but as I've observed in pastoral work, that there are many in the choir who are very domineering.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
And they know what songs they want to sing better than the one who's teaching them. Just because they've heard it on the radio, we ought to be able to do it like that. And as we all know, it don't work that way. But that kind of presence makes you secure in the anointing that is on your life. When there is an anointing on your life in ministry, God also gives you a boldness to carry out the assignment. And it's not always recognized, but it is always beneficial. Somebody miss that. It's not always recognized, but it's always, always beneficial. So I thank God for the anointing that was on his life and for the many cantankerous incidents and episodes that he had with the various people that may have not been recognized, but today we stand as a witness. It was beneficial. With that, we come to the close of this service. But let me interrupt just for a few seconds. Eric, Rafila, is there anything that you guys want to share before I do this? God has given us the gift of one Rodriguez Fernando Sullins, a.k.a. Cookie, Maestro, whatever you want to call it, as a gift to the body of Christ. We come to this point where God has already done what God is going to do. And it is non-negotiable. It is irreversible. Therefore, as a matter of practice and historical precedence, we now commend to the one who has given. We commend him back to God. We say in the expressions of the old Negro church, pastors ashes to ashes, dust to dust, earth to earth. As we look forward to and anticipate that great getting up morning, as I love to reminisce when all of God's children shall get together. What a time. What a time. What a time when we will be clothed in glorified fashion and glorified bodies. Not as this house here, which will go back to the dirt, to the earth, will be turned into ashes. But then we will be clothed with a body of which sin has no presence, not touched with sickness, with pain, with disease. But it will be new and refreshed every day. Again, we thank God for what he has done, for what he's doing even right now, and in faith for what he's going to do. Let us pray. God, we rejoice in the service today, for I believe your anointing has been all in it, all over it, all through it. And my prayer is that when we leave this place, although we will leave having been touched in various ways because of our path having crossed Fernando's path, but more than anything else, I pray that we will leave as better people. Better people who declare that we are saved, that we are sons and daughters of the Most High. We pray for Eric, with Sheila, his aunt, other family members, loved ones who have worked with him, who have sang with him, who have ministered with him, who have cared for him, a church that will miss his presence dearly. We pray for us as we continue now the journey that God has given to us. This is our prayer now, made in the matchless, mighty, magnificent name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. Let the church shout out, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Oh, one more time, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
I think he's worthy to be praised. Praise the Lord. God bless you.
Staff of McKenzie's funeral home, I'd like to thank you for this opportunity to serve you during your time of bereavement. And at this time, this is going to conclude the services for Mr. Sullins. We're going to ask that we have a few young ladies to please come forward that would like to serve as flower bearers, please.